Dr. Vijayakumar, I think you're online now, and as the host, I think we can begin the session.
Were you able to see my screen on yours?
Yes, sir. We're able to see your presentation.
So, good afternoon, my friends. So, it's my privilege and my happiness to meet you all from Chennai and to deliver the topic on the decoding ventilator graphics. When Dr. Murali Chakravarti has requested me to deliver the topic on the pressure volume loops, I told him that I have an interesting presentation, which I gave it in the raw online webinars, and it was appreciated by many students. So I thought that may be an appropriate topic for you all people to have an idea about this decoding ventilator graphics. As we all know, we used to see day and out every day, even in the anesthesia ventilators or the critical care unit ventilators, used to see many graphics. And when we want to order a ventilator to our units, we like to see the graphics, the colorful graphics in the screen. And with that particular screens, taking it as an important future of the particular ventilator, and we'll get that. But after that, even though we see quite frequently the ventilator graphics, the interest on decoding that ventilator graphics and derive some interesting features in that particular ventilator graphics is not routinely practiced. But this lecture will give you an idea about the ventilator graphics and why the ventilator graphic studies are very important in our day-to-day practice in managing the critically ill and as far as the anesthetized patients. So in this 40 minutes of topic, I like to divide the topics into four main things. The first, the heading on which we like to discuss is about the law of motion. It's nothing but a basic physics which you are going to refresh to understand the details in the other three following headings. And I will introduce you all to the graphics. What do you mean by the graphics and other thing? And I'll put all the graphs and we'll dissect the each and every graph parts for you all to understand the importance of the parts in the particular graphs. And after understanding the anatomy about each and every graphics in the ventilator, we like to decode it to understand the facts hidden behind this particular graphics. And this decoding, I try to make it simplified so that you can go through the graphics very fast to understand and grab the features. So ventilator and the graph means it's nothing but all the pressures. In the diagram, you can see the airway pressures and the pressures inside the pleura. And this is the diagrammatic description about the entire airway system. It starts from the nose and goes through the trachea and divides in the right and left main bronchus and try to ventilate both the lungs. And this lung has been pulled out by the pleural pressure. If it is negative, you will have the inflation of the lung. If it is positive, you will have a passive exhalation of the lungs into the atmosphere. And the diaphragm acts as a piston and it tries to pull and accommodate the inflated lung in the thoracic cavity. And these airways are get connected by the endotracheal tube to the ventilator here. And let us study about the pressures in this respiratory system. This can be divided into two major elements, are two major sections, and one particular element is a resistive element, and another element is the elastic element. And this respiratory system is nothing but the mechanical system. Resistive element and the elastic elements are there in the series, one after the other. Let us first see about the resistive element in the respiratory system. And the resistance to the airflow is given by the airways. And if the patient has an endotracheal tube, that can also give the resistance. And that we call it as resistive element. And this resistive element is depends upon the flow and resistance offered. If the flow is more, the resistance will be more. If the resistance is more, the flow is restricted. So the airway pressure, the resistive element is offered by the flow and the resistance in the system. And coming to the elastic element of this respiratory system, the elastic element is given by the lung parenchyma and the chest wall. The elastic pressure varies with the volume and stiffness of the lung and chest wall. And so, the elastic pressure is indirectly proportional to the complaints of the lung and the chest wall. And the elastic pressure, it depends directly on the volume which we try to deliver into the lung tissue. So at any given point of time, the airway pressure, if you are measuring a pressure in the particular airway, and it depends on the four elements, flow, resistance, and the volume which try to deliver into the lungs, and the complaints of the lung and the chest wall. So this is a combination of resistive element and the elastic element, which determines the airway pressure at any given point of time. Let us see if suppose this respiratory system is connected to the ventilatory circuit. Essentially, the circuit diagram of a mechanically ventilated patient can also be broken down into two parts. One is the ventilator part, and this makes the first part of the circuit. And here, the ventilator acts like a pump, depicted simplistically as a piston, and that moves in the reciprocating fashion during the respiratory cycle. The ventilator tries to push the air into the patient's respiratory system, the piston will come down. At the same time, the another element in the ventilator circuit is the diaphragm. So diaphragm and the ventilator are the two pistons acting on the opposite direction at any given time. So the patient's own respiratory system makes a second part of the circuit. The diaphragm is also shown as a second piston, causing air to be drawn into the lungs during its contraction. If the diaphragm contracts, the piston moves down and it allows the space to get occupied by the inflated lung, and the inflated lung is inflated by another piston from the ventilator. So if the ventilator has to work on the respiratory system of the patient, usually it will get connected by the endotracheal tube. And for all practical purposes, the endotracheal tube is concerned as a continuation of the airways of the patient. So there comes the law of gas motion in the ventilator circuit. Let us now understand how the respiratory system inherits the elastance and the resistance to the airflow determines the pressure generated within the mechanically ventilated system. So if you want to drive 500 ml of volume into the patient's lung, the ventilator has to work on the resistive element and the elastic element. And this resistive element, we already discussed, it contains two parts, resistance offered by the endotracheal tube, resistance offered by the airways. Combined together, the ventilator has to overcome the resistance of these two systems. And at the same time, the ventilator has to overcome the elastic resistance given by the lungs and the chest wall. So for any given point of time, the ventilator has to push the air into the patient's respiratory system. It has to overcome the resistive and elastic element of the respiratory system, and this is the equation called law of gas motions. So after understanding the gas law motion, what are the physical variables which plays a major role in the ventilator? There are only four physical variables which determines the movement of the air from the ventilator to the patient and from the patients to the ventilator to get exhaled through the ventilator circuit. The pressure, volume, flow, and time. And remember, the units of pressure in the ventilator graphics is centimeter H2O, volume is ml, flow is liter per minute, and most of the time it can also be used as liter per second, and the time is also per second. So if you put these four variables in the graphs, and the graphs, you all know, there are two axes in the graph. One is y-axis and another one is the x-axis. To remember the y-axis, y to the sky, it always looks up, and x to the left, it may go to the left and right, so it is horizontal. And the x-axis and the y-axis can accommodate any of these four variables in the ventilator. And there are many ventilators where you can choose the option of putting these four variables in the x and y axis to get the graphics the way you want. But whenever you go near to the ventilator graphic, you just remember one thing. If the graph is allowed to run continuously, then you will have the waveforms. And that is, then it is called from the graphic to the graphic waves. There are only two types of ventilator graphics. One is ventilator scalar, the time scalar we will call, and another one is called the loops. And in the scalars, we have only three scalars: the pressure time scalar, volume time scalar, and the flow time scalar. If you come to the loop, there are only two loops available. One is the pressure volume loop, and another one is flow volume loop. So when you decide to go and look into the waveforms, the two important things you have to understand at the outset, and always see the waveforms in the volume control ventilation. If you want to derive more information about the graphics and the graph waveforms in the ventilator, better you should go for the volume control modes so that you can get more information out of it. The pressure time scalar and the pressure volume loop are the two important preferred waveforms to be analyzed first and without fail always. So let us see each and every waveforms separately. Coming to the scalars are the waveform representations of pressure, flow, volume on the y-axis, and here the time is always in the x-axis. So put the time in the x-axis, and if you want to have the variables pressure, flow, volume on the x-axis, then definitely you can have the scalars called pressure, flow, volume scalars, or pressure time, flow time, volume time scalars. So coming to the flow versus time scalars. So this is the first one, is called flow versus time scalar. You will have the inspiratory arm and you'll have the expiratory arm in the opposite direction if you have the flow and time scalar. But if you have the pressure versus time scalar, it is always unidirectional. There is no opposite arm in the opposite direction, but you definitely have the inspiratory part and the expiratory part in the scalar. And the third one is the volume versus time scalar. And coming to the loops, loops are representations of pressure versus volume or flow versus volume. And here, you have to concentrate one thing. If you look into the pressure and volume loop, you see the pressure is in the x-axis and volume is in the y-axis. But when it comes to the flow and volume loop, remember the volume is in the x-axis and the flow in the y-axis. If you change these two variables in the axis, you will get a different waveforms of no use. But If you put the variables exactly like this, then you will have a very nice representations of pressure volume loop and the flow volume loops. And when come to the loops, you should know what is the inspiratory arm and what is the expiratory arm. The pressure volume loops, you will have the inspiratory arm starts like this, and it will go as an expiratory arm in the reverse anti-clockwise. But in case of flow volume loops, the expiratory arm is down and the inspiratory arm is up. It is dissected by the horizontal x-axis like this. Or otherwise, here the y-axis is divided as a positive and also as a negative form. So this is pressure volume loop and this one is flow volume loop. The first thing, as we already discussed, the two waveforms you have to concentrate, one is the pressure time scalar and another one is pressure volume loops. And if you run the pressure time scalar continuously as a real time, that it is a waveform, the pressure time scalar waveform. And you all know it has to be studied in a volume control and it should not be in the pressure control. Here, remember the volume and flow are constant. We are going to assess how the pressure changes happening in the ventilator circuit. The pressure time waveform is the reflection of the pressures generated within the airways during each phase of the ventilatory cycle. So let us see how it runs as a real time. So at the beginning of the inspiratory cycle, the ventilator has to generate a pressure to overcome the airway resistance. So the initial part of the pressure time scalar, when the ventilator tries to push the air inside, it has to overcome the resistance offered by the endotracheal tube and the airways. And here, you will have a rise in pressure. And if you continue like this, the pressure rises in a linear fashion to finally reach the peak airway pressure. And at the end of the peak airway pressure, at the end of the inspiration, air flow is zero and the pressure drops by an amount equal to the pressure resistant to reach the plateau pressure. And from the plateau pressure, the passing expiration will finish up the pressure time scalar like this. So here, if you look into that, this part is the resistive force against which the ventilator has to push the air into the patient's airway. And it's same thing here also. It's equal to this, from where no flow happens, but the pressure drops coming down like this. And it reaches the plateau pressure and it's a passive expiration. So till more, the dissection, that's the anatomical dissection of the pressure time scalar. It starts here. If you don't keep any peep, the airway pressure, it will start from here. So when you keep the peep, from here the pressure starts to mount up to overcome the resistance offered by the patient's airway. And after that, the pressure in the respiratory system rises linearly to reach the peak airway pressure. And once it reaches the peak airway pressure, delivered the tidal volume, which has been fixed in by the ventilator in the volume control mode. And after that, the pressure drops down and it reaches the point D. So AB is equal to CD. And this is called the resistive pressure. When you want to find out the resistance happening in the ventilator circuit, when you want to calculate the airway resistance, this is the pressure which we have to take. The difference between the peak airway pressure and the plateau pressure. But when you want to check the compliance, the static compliance of the lung, the pressure which we have to take is the difference between the plateau pressure and the peep. So this is called compliance pressure. And this is the peep. And this is the area called inspiratory time. And here the cycle from the inspiration to the expiration starts, and this is called expiratory time. And this is how we'll dissect the pressure time scalar to understand our future discussions. And coming to the flow time scalar, as we already discussed, you will have a one positive and one negative part. This positive part is called inspiration, and negative part is called expiration. And this is the flow time scalar. An inspiratory time is always the tidal volume divided by the flow rate. And we already know that if you want to analyze the waveforms, better to be analyzed in the volume control. Since if the patient is switched over to the pressure control mode of ventilation, the total change is happening in the graphics. As far as the scalars is concerned, just have a look how it looks different when the patient is in the pressure control mode and when the patient is in the volume control mode. By looking at the graphs itself, you can say that whether the patient's in the pressure control mode or in the volume control mode. Volume control mode, you can have a very nice descriptions of all the scalars, which we discussed already. But when the moment you change to the pressure control mode, the volume time scalar will change like this. It's a flattening of the inspiratory part. If you take the flow time scalar in the pressure control mode, you can see it will be like the triangle pattern instead of having a rectangular pattern in the volume control mode. And the pressure time scalar, which we are able to derive many more informations, and that pressure time scalar will change like this. It will become a rectangular without any peak airway pressure and the plateau airway pressure, because the pressure here is constantly maintained. So you will have only the set pressure in the ventilator. If suppose you are set the pressure as 20 cm H2O, it will deliver the volume only to reach this particular pressure. So we are losing the information about the peak airway pressure, plateau airway pressure, and the resistant pressure, and the compliance pressure and everything. So better to analyze the scalars in the volume control mode. And coming to the second important graphic or the waveform in the ventilator is the pressure volume loops. If you look into the pressure volume loops, if it is a mandatory breath, every breath is delivered by the ventilator without any efforts from the patient, the pressure volume loop starts from the zero. It will go like this, the anti-clockwise as an inspiratory waveform. And from there, it will move the counterclockwise as an expiration and reach the area here if you are not keeping any peep. And this, if it is going to be the spontaneous breath volume control mode, the inspiration started in the negative side because of the negative pressure developed in the pleura. Here, the inspiratory wave will go in a clockwise and reaches as a expiratory wave and touches the zero pressure there. If the patient is having an assisted breath, so the moment patient generates a negative pressure in the airway, it is sensed by the ventilator, and the inspiration is given like a mandatory breath, and from here it will become an expiration and join the pressure. If you are keeping the peep, and the peep will be reflected here in the pressure volume loop. So let us again dissect how we dissected the pressure time scalar. Let us dissect the anatomy of the PV loop here. So when you keep the peep, naturally the respiration starts from here, the pressure. The pressure is in the x-axis, volume is in the y-axis. And this is the area. It starts as the inspiratory limb like this. Once the alveoli, the collapsed alveoli, started distending, you will develop the pressure in the airway. And this is the pressure called lower inflection point. And from here, you can start recruiting more and more of alveoli to reach this area. Once this inspiration gets over and it comes as the expiratory limb, and here one another point, that point is called upper inflection point. And the pressure at which there is regional global distension beyond that, and coming to the expiration, the volume starts dropping and the pressure is also started dropping and it will reach the peep here. So alveolar recruitment, the airway resistance is overcome here up to the lower inflection point, and this is the optimal compliance of the lung. And if you try to overcome the compliance of the lung by increasing the volume to be delivered, and you will have a beaking. And this beaking or the dolphin sign is called, or it is due to over distension of the alveoli. So what we have to do is, we have to ventilate the patient in between the lower inflection point and the upper inflection point. And if this is going to be the pressure volume loop described like this, if you go away from here, you will causing alveolar over distension. The patient can go for a wallo trauma. And if suppose you are not recruiting the alveoli properly and leaving the alveolar collapsed in this area, it is not good and the oxygenation will never happen. So the protective alveolar ventilation lies between these A and B, or the in between the lower inflection point and the upper inflection point. And here, remember the variable is volume and the flow is constant in the PV loops. So PV loops can be assessed very clearly only when the patient is totally paralyzed on the ventilator without any assistive breath, without any the assisted breath. And let us see what the changes will happen once the patient is moved from the volume controlled ventilation to the pressure controlled ventilation. The PV loop changes like this. So almost it becomes flattened. So the informations are very meager when it is analyzed in the pressure support ventilations. A small amount of effort by the patient to produce a negative pressure and it triggers the ventilator and it gives the pressure supported ventilation. The rapid inspiratory flow produces a rapid rise in pressure, some of which is due to the airway resistant and some due to resistance of the collapsed alveoli, and it goes and touches here. And if you draw a line between the beginning of inspiration and the end of the inspiration like this, and this line will give you whether it's getting shifted to the right or getting shifted to the left. And coming to the less significant as far as the ventilator is concerned, but the same flow volume loops are more significant in the spirometry. And when you are asking for a pulmonary function test, the flow volume loops carries an increased significance. But the same loses its importance when the patient is on ventilator. And this is the flow volume loop seen in the ventilators. The inspiratory limb will be up like this, and the expiratory limb will be like this. And the volume starts from zero and start moving away from towards the right side like this. And this is will give you the tidal volume, and the peak part of this inspiration is called peak inspiratory flow rate, and peak part here is called peak expiratory flow rate in the flow volume loop. And you all should understand the difference between the spirometry flow volume loops and the ventilator showing flow volume loops. It's totally ulta. The forced expiration, that is what we do in a spirometry. We'll ask the patient to inhale to the maximum, and we'll ask the patient to exhale forcefully through the spirometry so that the graph is taken like this. So in the spirometry, you'll have a forced expiration above and active inspiration down like this. But when in a mechanically ventilated patient, the ventilated respirations, the ventilator inspiration is a forced one, and the patient exhales passively in the ventilator, and it's called passive expiration, and the flow volume loop will be like this. In spirometry, it's totally different. It's going to be useful as a pulmonary function test, and that is a big topic we have to discuss separately. Here, I like to give you the difference between the spirometry flow volume loops and ventilator flow volume loops. After knowing all these waveforms and the graphics, what is the significance of knowing these graphs and waveforms on the ventilator? You all know the asynchrony between the patient and the ventilator is a big problem in a ventilated patient. And there are various studies which have shown very clearly This asynchrony between the patient and the ventilator increases the ICU mortality and fivefold, and threefold increase happens in the days of ventilation and twofold increase length of stay in the hospital. So the interpretation of graphics is aimed to identify and to prevent the dyssynchrony, and that is the ultimate aim of analyzing these waveforms. So here comes how to decode the waveforms or the ventilator graphics, and this is the simplified way of decoding the ventilator graphics and waveform. I like to advise you people to divide the phases of respiration like this and analyze the waveforms. We can divide the phases of respiration, the inspiratory trigger phase, the inspiratory phase, and the expiratory trigger phase or the expiratory cycle point and the expiratory phase. So you'll have two main phases. One is inspiratory phase and another one is the expiratory phase. And to trigger the inspiration, there is one phase which have to be analyzed in the waveforms. And to move from the inspiratory phase to the expiratory phase, in between these two phases, you will have an expiratory trigger or the cycle phase. And here I try to give some important findings which you have to understand and detect on the waveforms and the graphics to prevent the desynchronization or disharmony between the ventilator and the patient. In case of an inspiratory trigger phase, these are the three big problems: the auto-triggering, missed triggering, and the double triggering. And come to the inspiratory phase, you can identify the problems and you can have the solutions. For an example, you can identify the flow hunger, the airway resistance you can calculate, you can calculate the lung compliance, the static compliance, and you can decide and select an ideal PEEP, an ideal plateau pressure in an ARDS patient. And come to the expiratory trigger or the cycle phase, you have the problems of delayed cycling and premature cycling. When come to the expiratory phase and you study the waveforms in the expiratory phase of the waveforms, you can identify the auto PEEP of your patients and you can identify whether the patient's in the bronchospasm and the patient is having a leak. So I put it like this: the 1.1 is one problem, 1.2, 1.3. 2.1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 3.1 and 3.2, 4, 1, 2, 3, and discuss each one separately. And before going into that, this is the phases of respiration. The phase 1 is the inspiratory trigger phase. And the phase 2 is the inspiratory phase. And the phase 3 is a cycle which happens from the inspiration to the expiration. And the phase 4 is the expiratory phase of the wall pressure of the waveforms. And coming to this trigger phase problems, you see there is no trigger. Patient is in a control mode of ventilation. But when the same patient is coming out of muscle relaxants, and if having a very minimal negative pressure developed in the circuits, then it's an acceptable trigger and it will be sensed by the ventilator and give the inspiratory breath. If same thing is going to be the excessive trigger, that means the patient develops a negative pressure, and this negative pressure is called excessive trigger work. And here you can see the patient is able to trigger, but the ventilator is forgot to give a good inspiratory thing, and that is called missed triggers. In the trigger phase, you will have the important problem, the auto-triggering. What do you mean by auto-triggering? Without any negative pressure developed by the patients on its own, the circuit feels that the trigger has happened and started giving the breath. So when it happens, usually the patient is get an increased amount of tidal volume. So which causes this auto-triggering? When you have a circuit leaks, the leak can give you the auto-triggering. If there is any water in the circuit, that can trigger the ventilator. And the same cardiac oscillations, that can be sensed as a trigger by the ventilator and give the auto triggering. When you connect the patient with a nebulizer, that nebulizer can act as a auto triggering. if anything leak in the chest tube, the ICDs, that can act as a negative pressure development and can trigger the ventilator. So the remedy is very simple. Fix the leak, empty the water, increase the trigger values or the sensitivity, flow trigger or anything you can increase on the ventilator, and or otherwise change to the pressure trigger. So these are the remedies by which we can offer by seeing the ventilator graphics and identifying the auto triggering. And what will happen if the trigger is missed? And that can happen in a high pressure support. If the patient is kept in a very high pressure support, for an example, if you want to deliver 500 ml of tidal volume to the patient, but you are allowing the pressure support up to 30, where the 30 pressure support can accommodate more volume, to leave your patient with a higher tidal volume always, or otherwise the patient's respiratory system is loaded with the lung. So the high pressure support may be associated with the reduction in inspiratory drive and ineffective trigger. High tidal volume, if you keep, that will happen. So we have to come down in the tidal volume. The alkaline pH and increased bicarbonate levels that can have the increased respiratory attempts, that will suppress the respiratory attempts, can have the problem. In a chronic obstructive pulmonary disease patient where they have a dynamic hyperinflation, they will forget the triggers and that will end up in having a missed trigger problem. And let us see what you mean by double triggering. High peak airway pressures and double the inspiratory volume which you had kept in the ventilator, then you can suspect double triggering. Continued patient inspiratory effort through the end of the delivered breath causes the ventilator to trigger again and deliver the second breath immediately after the first one, which results in high lung volumes and the pressure. So the causes are the patient flow or volume demand exceeds ventilator settings. So consider decreasing the tidal volume, switching the mode from the volume to the pressure support, increasing the sedation, or the neuromuscular paralysis, so that we can avoid the. And coming to the second phase of respiration, where you can identify the problem called flow hunger. In the pressure time waveform or the scalar, if you see this kind of scooping or distortion instead of a smooth rise in the pressure, there you can identify the flow hunger. The patient having a more negative pressure developed, so that before the patient ventilator delivering the volume, you will have an exhausted volume delivered, you will have a scoop like this. That's called scooping of the pressure waveform, indicating the flow hunger, and you have to increase the flow on the ventilator to overcome this problem. And this is an important phase where you can derive more information about your patient. From the one pressure time scalar, and in the inspiratory phase of that particular pressure time scalar, you can derive so many informations. For an example, in this graph, you just see, this is the peak airway pressure of 40 centimeter H2O and the plateau pressure of 30 centimeter H2O, where the set volume in the volume control mode is a 500 ml as a tidal volume, and the flow is 60 liter per minute or otherwise 1 liter per second, and the square waveform is set for the flow. So here, if you want to check the airway resistance on your patient, this is the formula. Airway resistance is directly proportional to the pressure, indirectly proportional to the flow. So R is equal to P divided by flow. As we always already discussed, when you want to measure the resistance in the circuit, the resistive pressure which you have to take is the point between C and D, or A and B. So this is called resistive pressure. So the difference between the peak airway pressure and the plateau airway pressure should be taken as the pressure to assess the airway pressure in the circuit. So 40 minus 30 divided by 1, that is 1 liter per second. It will give you the airway resistance 10 centimeter H2O for every liter of flow per second. So this is airway resistance is derived. And if you want to calculate the static complaints of your patient by seeing the pressure volume loop, pressure time scalar, In the inspiratory phase, you can measure the static complaints of the patient. So it is volume divided by the pressure. And we already discussed, if you want to measure compliance, and this is the compliance pressure. The difference between the plateau pressure and the PEEP is the compliance pressure. And this is 30 minus 5, 25. And the tidal volume which we are planned to deliver is 500 ml. To deliver 500 ml of tidal volume, it requires the pressure of 20 centimeter H2O. So indirectly, for 1 centimeter H2O, you can deliver 20 ml on your lung, and that is called the static compliance of the lung. By looking at the pressure time scalar at the distance, you can identify if the peak airway pressure is high, that means the increased resistance to the flow, it can be in the endotracheal tube or in the airway of the patient like bronchospasm or the tube obstruction. That can cause peak inspiratory pressure in the pressure time scalar. But at the same time, if the plateau pressure is also trying to move from its normal level to meet the peak inspiratory pressure, the difference between the peak inspiratory pressure and the plateau pressure is increases means it's a decreased lung compliance. And this decreased lung compliance is due to pneumonia, ARDS, pulmonary edema, or it may also due to the abdominal distension and sprinting of the diaphragm. So coming to the flow volume loops, and if you want to study in the inspiratory part, inspiratory phase, you can identify here also the decreased compliance happens. So in a restrictive diseases, it did nothing but reduce the volume of the lung, the curve would look rather normal but diminish in size as depicted below. Instead of having a tidal volume up to here, in a restrictive lung, where the patient is having a decreased compliance, it will just shrink the flow volume loop like this. And by looking at it, you may think that the flow volume loops are normal, but it's having a very less volume and it will be shrinked in a decreased compliance. And same thing, steep end expiratory flow curve and steep expiratory flow curve, reduced tidal volume can also say you that it is a restrictive lung disease. And when you identify the problems, can you identify any important variables which can help your patient? For an example, you can identify the ideal PEEP in a pressure volume loops, and you can select the ideal plateau pressures also. So this is the normal pressure volume loop. When the patient is having a decreased lung compliance, or otherwise when the lung becomes stiff, for an example in ARDS, the pressure volume loop, the axis like this, it will start falling down, move towards the right and down. And then it is called decreased compliance of the lung. So by looking at the pressure volume loop, if it is down facing horizontally, then you can call it as a decreased lung compliance and ARDS. Patient's lungs becoming stiff and stiffer. And this is the lower inspiratory pressure, and another one is the upper inspiratory pressure. The compliance is reduced when this curve shifted to the right side. Upper inflection, lower inflection period will help you and tell you an idea. The lower inflective pressure is an ideal peak. You have to keep on your patient to recruit the alveoli at the optimal level. And the upper inflection point will give you the P plat you have to accept in the ARDS. And coming to the third phase of the respiratory cycle, here we can identify two important problems called premature cycle and the delayed cycling. Premature cycling will cut down the volume delivered to the patient. Delayed cycling will deliver more volume to the patient and end up in having a wall or trauma. So this we have to identify in this phase. And coming to the most important phase, again, like an inspiratory phase, the expiratory phase will give you more details. The one detail which we can derive in the expiratory phase is called auto-PEEP, or the otherwise over-distension, or otherwise you can call it as air trapping. All these things can be identified in the flow time scalar or in the flow volume loop. And you just see, this is an inspiratory limb. and the inspiratory limb will become flattened and you have an obstruction, and the expiratory limb will be scooped like this. The scooping of the expiratory flow tells you that there is an obstruction, and here you can see it is not touching zero here, and this particular thing is called gas trapping. And if you see the flow volume loop like this without ending and touching the zero point here, then you can call it as an auto PEEP is developing on your patient. And the same thing can be derived in the flow time scalar. In the flow time scalar, this is the normal curve. And once the patient start developing an air trapping or the auto PEEP, the expiratory limb will never touch the zero point here, and you'll have a gap like this, and this gap will give you the gas trapping. And coming to the bronchodilator response, which can happen in the expiratory phase of your flow volume loops. So this is a normal curve, and this is the bronchospasm developing on your patient in the circuit, and that can be seen by the changes happening in the normal flow volume loop, and you'll have a decreased expiratory peak expiratory flow, and you'll have a scooping of this expiratory limb. And once you give a bronchodilator, you can see the changes happening in the flow volume loop going back to the normalcy. And the other problem, the air leak problems, can be detected in if you look the waveforms in the expiratory phase. So decreased peak inspiratory pressure, and you can see the decreased peak expiratory flow here, and you will have a decreased return volume, and this is called air leak. And if you look into the pressure volume loops, it starts from the PEEP here. This is the inspiratory limb, and it starts the expiratory limb. And if you have any air leak in the circuit, it will never touch the zero here. And where it stops at that particular volume is the leak happening in the circuit. So here in this graph, 200 ml is the volume lost, and that is the leak. And same thing, the leak can also be measured if you look into the flow volume loop. The inspiratory limb starts like this and comes as an expiratory limb, and before touching the zero point here, this is the air leak happening. And this air leak can be measured here. It's a 75 ml of volume is lost as an air leak. So the take-home messages. The ventilator graphics are very important tool in the management of ventilated patients. Concentrate on the pressure time scalar and the pressure volume loop in the volume control ventilation to get maximum information from these waveforms. Our aim in interpretation of ventilator graphics, remember, is to prevent patient ventilator dyssynchrony or desynchronization, or the fight between the ventilator and the patient. So if you prevent this, the disharmony is prevented so that the patient have the higher chances of coming back from the ventilator at the earliest and can go home. Interpretation of graphics are simplified if you divide the respiration into phases and study it, or otherwise you can develop your own way of decoding these graphics to derive more information. Thank you. I'm happy to answer your questions.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Vijay Kumar, for an excellent and very elaborate presentation on the ventilator graphics, commonly which we encounter. And I would invite the participant to raise any of their queries and have them answered. Participant, kindly unmute your mics before you raise your query. Otherwise, we cannot make out who is speaking what.
And don't be shy to show your face also. I think they are very tired after long work. Ravi, you are a busy OT list today?
Reasonably. Okay. Actually, right now we have only 3 theaters running.
Okay.
But so as a corollary, my teachers used to tell me that if there are no questions, then the topic is very well explained that you don't have any questions, or it is totally over the head. It has gone totally over the head. Whatever the context, I must thank you for an excellent elaboration. And going back to what my teachers taught me, spending hours together in the ICU, standing beside the ventilator, explaining each and every one of the graphics, this, in a concise way, it brought me back to that time. And I must really thank you for an excellent presentation, sir. And hopefully, all the participants will be able to make use of this knowledge in their day-to-day practice and give the best of care that the patient deserves. So, thank you once again, sir, Dr. Vijay Kumar.
Thank you. It's
for your presentation. Thank you, sir.